mighty God. Worship him. He's the Ancient of Days. He's the same yesterday, the same today, the same forever. Magnify his holy name. Thank him for all he has done for you. Particularly from the beginning of the year till now. Thank him for January. Thank him for February. Thank him for March. Thank him for April. Thank him for May. Now thank him for June. Give him glory. Give him honor. He is worthy. Worthy to be praised. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have given thanks. We want to pray for all traditional rulers. I want you to lift your voice to God and say, Father, in the kingdom of these your children, let there be peace. Go ahead, talk to the Almighty God. Let there always be peace and progress and joy and success. In the kingdoms of your children, Lord God Almighty, let there be no problems at all. No trouble. No disturbance. Just progress and peace and joy. Yes, Lord, do it for them, so that the world will know that it pays to serve God. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. And let's pray for all fathers, young and old, including those who are believing God that one day they too will become fathers. That the Almighty God will still every storm in their homes. That God himself will be the controller of every situation in their homes. Let's go ahead and talk to the Almighty God. We are praying for all fathers today, Lord, young and old, including potential fathers, that you will take control of every situation in their homes, that there be no more storms in their homes, that you will give them everything they need to be successful fathers, successful husbands. It will provide them everything they need to take care of their children, take care of their homes. Yes, Lord, bless all fathers. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Then why don't you cry to God for yourself and say, Father, let this month be very successful for me. Go ahead, talk to the Almighty. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Oh Lord. Alleluia. Almighty King of glory, the I am that I am, the unchangeable changer, the most high, the one that's higher than the highest, the one who is stronger than the strongest, the one who is older than the oldest, the one who is wiser than the wisest. Glory be to your holy name. Please accept our worship in Jesus' name. Thank you for January. Thank you for February. Thank you for March. Thank you for April. Thank you for May. Thank you for June. Father, accept our thanks in Jesus' name. Today, Father, we are committing all terror. There will be no tragedy. There will only be progress. There will always be abundance. Father, if there's anyone trying to cause any kind of storm in their kingdoms, Father, arrest the fellow. I pray, Lord God Almighty, that in all their kingdoms, every force of darkness will be put to flight. Amen. That your light will shine. And we commit all fathers into your hands, Lord. Please, everything they need to be good fathers, provide for them. Any kind of storm in their families, Father, put an end to it. As for those who are trusting you, that one day they too will become fathers, Lord, I pray you provide them with good wives. And Lord God Almighty, if there are those who are married and they are trusting you for children so that they too can become fathers, answer them this month. Father, I'm committing all your children who have been faithful in the payment of their tithes and the giving of their offerings into your hands. This month, surprise them. Bless them beyond measure. Everything they touch, let it prosper. Answer all our prayers today and take all the glory. Please, Almighty God, have mercy on Nigeria and all the nations of the world where they are listening to us this day. Please, Lord, have mercy on them all. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Amen. Well, let someone shout hallelujah. Well, we've managed to put your hand to one or two people and say good morning. God bless you. And then you may please be seated. Today we are talking about the sure mercies of David, Isaiah 55. Isaiah 55, verse 3. Isaiah 55, verse 3. Incline your ear and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David. Sure mercies of David. Three crucial words here. The first one is the noun, mercies. The second one is the adjective that follows it, sure. And then the third one, of course, is David. What is mercy? Mercy is a word that has so many other words that can be associated with it. Grace, compassion, kindness. Several other good words. In the language of the market woman, mercy is that what gets you what you don't deserve. That's in the language of the common person. Language of the market woman, language of those who have not gone to the school of theology, language of people like me, who don't know much. We know mercy gets you what you don't deserve. Every good thing that you want, that you don't even deserve, may the mercy of God give it to you today. In Mark chapter 10, verse 46 to 52, Mark 10, 46 to 52, the beggar called Bartimaeus, who was blind, begged for mercy. And said, who am I to be calling on the King of Kings to come and do something for me, but just mercy. And mercy got him what he wanted. In Matthew 15, from verse 21 to 28, Matthew 15:21-28. A woman came to Jesus Christ and said, "Help me. My daughter is grievously vexed of the devil." You know the story. Jesus Christ said, "I can't give the bread of children to dogs." He said, "I know I'm a dog. I'm just asking for mercy." And she got what she wanted. In Mark chapter 1, verse 40 to 45, Mark chapter 1, 40 to 45, the Bible tells us that a leper came to Jesus, fell at his feet, and said, "I know you have the ability to heal me. What I am not sure is whether you'll be willing." The Bible says, Jesus, moved by compassion. That's another word for mercy. Jesus, moved by compassion, touched him and said, "I'm willing. Be thou cleansed." When God decides to show mercy, he will break all rules, because one of the cardinal rules in the olden days is that a priest must not touch a leper. But anybody who touches a leper is supposed to remain unclean till the evening. Stay away from everybody. Don't touch any other person until the evening, so that you don't transfer the leprosy to somebody else. But Jesus, who made the rule, broke the rule in order to have mercy on a leper. Now, every rule that God must break today in order to give you your miracle, may you get it through the mercy of God. And something very interesting about God. God can say, "Gold is mine, silver is mine," and we'll be speaking the truth. He can say, "The earth is mine, and the fullness thereof," and we'll be speaking the truth, because he created everything. But when he wants to tell you how rich he is, he will say, "I am rich in mercy." Rich in mercy. Ephesians chapter 2, from verse 4 to 6. Ephesians 2, 4 to 6. God boasts of his wealth as regards mercy. Now, the adjective there, sure. What does sure mean? Again, in the language of us commoners, it means certain, it means settled, it means unchangeable, it means fixed. When God wants to talk about foundation, his foundation, he said, "This foundation of God standeth sure." It's a foundation that you can rely upon. So sure means this one is a settled matter. Now, when God wants to describe how sure is mercy towards David is, he talks about it as if it is a covenant. Now, we young people don't know the meaning of covenants. The elders can tell you. When two elders enter into a covenant, usually you break the covenant,
you die. The elders will say, you break a covenant. The word they use for breaking a covenant is, what's the correct word now? They say, you insult the earth. If we break a covenant, you insult the earth. And they say the result is that the earth will swallow. That's how strong the covenant is. Now, God said, when he was talking about his covenant or his promises to David, he said in Jeremiah 33, 20-21, he said, if it is possible for you to break my covenant with day and night, if it is possible for you to make sure that if there is night, there won't be a morning. Or if there is morning, there won't be a night. If you can do that, he said, then can you break my covenant with David? That's how strong the covenant of God with David is. It is sure, settled. Now, when it now comes to David, how come that God is talking about sure mercies of David? The reason the word sure was applied to the mercies of God concerning David is that not all mercies are sure. In other words, somebody may get mercy from God today and lose it tomorrow, for example. When you read 1 Samuel chapter 10, from verse 1 to 24, 1 Samuel chapter 10, from verse 1 to 24, there was a young man called Saul, and he was made a king. How could he become a king when he himself said, if you read 1 Samuel chapter 9, 1 Samuel chapter 9, you can read it from verse 1 to the end. The young man said, my tribe is the smallest tribe in Israel. If they are looking for a king, they should go and look for one among the biggest tribes. He said, my family is the smallest family in our tribe. So you come and pick somebody from the smallest family in the smallest tribe, and you say you want to make him king. It can only be God's mercy. You know, there might be one or two people who are here today who are sure, beyond all doubts, that it is the mercy of God that has made them who they are. If there's anybody like that, let me hear the fellow shout hallelujah. I've told you before, there are three ways of doing things: the good way, the bad way, and God's way. What do you mean by that? God is the Almighty. He does as he pleases. Nobody can argue with him. If he decides to be merciful to somebody, nobody can query him. I remember years ago when I was just a young Christian and I was trying to query God, how can you make Solomon king? The father was an adulterer. The mother was an adulteress of the worst type, the one that led to the death of her husband. You combine these two, you produce somebody, and you made that fellow king. God, I don't understand you. Some of you have heard this before. God said, is that so? I said, yes. He said, by the way, your mother, is she the first wife of your father? I said, no. How come that I bypassed the first wife and I went to the second wife and choose you out of that particular situation? I said, no more questions. Is there anybody here today that you know that you know, but for God, but for the mercy of God, you won't be where you are today? Do I hear that fellow shout hallelujah? Now, so God took this king Saul, a nobody, from a family that is unknown, in a tribe that is the least, and made him king. And then by the time you now go to 1 Samuel chapter 15, from verse 1 to 23, 1 Samuel 15, from verse 1 to 23, this king disobeyed God. He didn't obey him completely. And God says, I take away my kingdom. I'm the one who gave you. I take it away. His fault? He did not obey God completely. And then look at David. He was also a nobody. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, from verse 1 to 13. 1 Samuel 16, from verse 1 to 13. When God wanted to select somebody else to replace King Saul, he went to the house of Jesse and said, I will choose a king from among his boys. David was such a nobody, even in his father's house, that the father did not present him for consideration. But God picked him from the bush, took him above all the elders, and made him king. Okay, then you now go and read 1 Samuel chapter 11 from verse 1 to the end. 2 Samuel chapter 11 from verse 1 to the end, and you see what David did. He committed adultery, killed the husband of the woman, pretended to be a good king as soon as discovered that the wife was pregnant. He invited the husband from, who was a loyal soldier, invited him home and said, hey, how are you? I hope the battle is going well. That one said, yes, your majesty. Okay, eat and drink and go and spend some time with your wife. He pretended to be a very good king. And the man said, how can I go to sleep with my wife when fellow soldiers are at the battlefront? So he refused to go out of loyalty to his king. The second day, the king discovered that this fellow hasn't gone home, so he couldn't cover what's going on. To cut a long story short, he gave the order to kill this man, and told the man to carry the order himself to the commander-in-chief. And God was watching. The king, the poor soldier died for being loyal. And then David pretended further to be a good king. He said, sorry, my soldier died. Don't let the widow suffer. Go, come and be living in the palace. Then God looked down from heaven and sent a messenger to him in 2 Samuel chapter 12. He told him a story
2 Samuel chapter 12, you can read this from verse 1 to 25. By the time the prophet finished telling the story, David said, "Whoever did that kind of thing in my kingdom shall be killed." The prophet said, "Well done, sir. You are the man." And then David opened his said more than I have seen. And the man of God said, "You are forgiven. Your sin is taken away. You will pay for it. You shall be punished because I'm a holy God. But don't worry, you are not going to die." So you see, there are mercies and there are mercies. Mercies that are not sure. Mercies that are sure. Now, which one do you want? You better let God hear you say it. So I had to sit down and study David a little bit. What is it that is so special about David that God who forgives so speedily, that God could still produce this same out of this man, someone who will sit on the throne? That God could say, as long as there is day after night, there will always be somebody on the throne of David. And whether you believe it or not, there is somebody sitting on that throne. His name is Jesus Christ. Bartimaeus said, "Thou son of David, have mercy on me." If he is sitting on that throne, he's the King of Kings, and he will be on that throne forever. What is so peculiar about David? I'm sure you want to know. Number one, when David repented, his repentance was genuine. When he said, "I'm done for, I've sinned," he meant it. He was truly, truly sorry. When you get home, I want you to read Psalm 51. Read it from the beginning to the end. He was crying to God. He said, "God, yes, Uriah was the fellow I killed, but it's not Uriah I've offended. It's you. It's against you that I've committed this terrible thing." He said, "Please, don't take your spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of your salvation. If you can just forgive me, I assure you it's not going to happen again." He was genuine. He wasn't a pretender. There are many people who come to the house of God, you give the altar call, they come forward, they pretend that they are saved, they are not. And you can't deceive God. He knows if you are sorry. He knows if you really mean it, that you will never again offend him. In the case of King Saul, that was removed before him, when the man of God told him in 1 Samuel chapter 15, if you can read from verse 24 to 30, hey, Agar,
you have offended God and God has rejected you. He said, I know, I've sinned. But man of God, just don't disgrace me before these people. You are being told that you are being replaced. You are still talking about the people. He said, well, just don't disgrace me before these people. The elders will tell you, it's only a goat who will hear of the day of his death and he will still be eating grass. The one before was a goat. The one, David, we are talking about, definitely was a sheep. Number two, he was humble. Oh, you want to see how humble he was? Read 2 Samuel chapter 6, from verse 14 to 16. 2 Samuel chapter 6, from verse 14 to 16. When David, when it's time to praise God, there's not even a member of his kingdom who could dance better. When he was dancing, the Bible records for us that even his belly came out of his flowing gown. He couldn't care less. He was dancing before the Almighty God. Because he was humble. And the Bible says God gives grace to the humble. God receives the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Like I told you earlier on, the word grace is another word that still means mercy. Not only that, number three, he was grateful. He knows how to show appreciation. Of course, he realizes where he was coming from. Now he has become great. He has not forgotten that it was God who made him great. David is the one who wrote and said, your gentleness has made me great. I'm nothing. It's because you just decided to be merciful unto me. That's why I'm something. In 2 Samuel chapter 6, from verse 20 to 22, 2 Samuel 6, 20 to 22, when he got home, after he had been doing that mighty dance, the Bible says he danced with all his might. The wife looked at him and said, what kind of thing are you? Dancing like a commoner. David said, dancing like a commoner. I was dancing before God, who took the kingdom from your father and gave it to me. He said, listen very well. You haven't seen anything yet. He thought I was dancing very well today. Wait, see tomorrow. I remember some years ago, one chief judge, I think it at that time they used to call the, it was a combination of Edo and Delta. I've forgotten what name the... The Midwest or something like that. Okay. And the chief judge gave his life to Jesus Christ. And then he led a delegation, I mean a group of Christians, whether on Christmas Day or Easter Day, to dance around the compound to advertise Jesus Christ. And then the governor summoned him and said, Chief Judge, I learned that you, the chief, my chief judge, was dancing in the street like a common man. He said, Your Excellency, your chief judge. I'm not your chief judge, I'm the chief judge made by the Most High. Long after the governor is gone, the Most High will still be on his throne. I was dancing for the Most High. I was dancing for the one who can never be removed from his position. They didn't vote him to power, so they can't vote him out of power. And I'm going to keep on dancing. Is there anybody here who will keep on praising God for the rest of your life? Let me hear you shout hallelujah. And David was a soul winner. He was a witness, a testifier. He said in Psalm 89, verse 1, Psalm 89, verse 1, he said, I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. With my mouth will I make known his faithfulness to all generations. He said, I will just keep talking about him. I can't keep my mouth shut. He has been good to me. Psalm 34, from verse 1 to 3. Psalm 34, from verse 1 to 3. He said, I will bless the Lord at all times. At all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Then in verse 3, he said, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. He was a witness. He refused to shut his mouth. And just one more. He was dedicated to God 100%. Dedicated to God 100%. One day he woke up in his palace and said, David, you are the one who has become this. Hey, look at your palace. And God is sleeping in an ark, just a tent. So I'm going to build a house for God. Such a house that nobody has ever seen it kind before. And God took note and sent his servant to go and tell him, David, sorry, you've been a warrior. There's blood. A lot of blood has been shed by your hand. You can build a house for me. But I will give that opportunity to your son. He will build a house. David said, is that so? The man of God said, yes, that's what God said. He said, no problem, no problem. Solo, you are the one that will build the house. Congratulations. I won't let you spend a cobble of your money. You will do the building, but the money that will build that house, not a cobble will come from any other source other from me. Then who is building the house? If you read 1 Chronicles chapter 22, verse 14, 1 Chronicles chapter 22, verse 14, he prepared 100,000 talents of gold. He prepared 1,000,000 talents of silver. He prepared brass, iron without weight. Everything that could be needed for the house, he provided for it. Why? He said, because I love my God. No wonder God himself said in Acts chapter 13 from verse 21 to 23, Acts 13 from verse 21 to 23, he said, I have found a man after my own heart who will do all my will. When God finds somebody who is 100% committed to Him, who is interested in only making God happy, when that fellow makes a little mistake, God forgives. That's what God Himself said. This boy who said, "I will bless the name of the Lord forever, His praise shall continually be in my mouth," God said, "My mercy for you will be sure." You know, in Psalm 27 verse 4, Psalm 27 verse 4, David said, "Only one thing I ask of the Lord, only one thing I seek after, just want to dwell in His house forever, just want to sit down there, observe His glory." Well, no wonder he said in Psalm 23 verse 6, Psalm 23 verse 6, he said, "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me." For how long? All the days of my life. Goodness and mercy. You know, in the name that's above every other name, I have the authority to declare to someone here today, for the rest of your life, you will enjoy sure mercies of God. But that is only for those who are genuinely committed to God. So if you have been pretending to be a Christian up to this moment, you've heard this morning, there are two kinds of mercies. It's the mercy of God that you have not been consumed, but will that mercy be sure? Will it last forever? The choice is yours. If you want to really, really surrender your life to Jesus Christ, the altar is open. Come, I will pray for your salvation, and you too can begin to enjoy the sure mercies of David for the rest of your life. I'm going to count from 1 to 7. If by the time I say 7, you are not standing before me here, before the altar of God, and we know you are not sure, or you don't want to really surrender your life. But if you want to really, really surrender your life to Jesus Christ, come now as I count. 1, 2, 3. Oh, the message of this morning is only for somebody in particular. So you might be the only one. You don't have to wait for anybody else. 4. Oh yes, David was truly repentant. When he said, "I'm sorry," he meant, "I'm sorry." You want to give your life to Jesus Christ? True salvation? Come now. 5. Hurry up if you are coming. This is your day. God bless you. You're welcome. 6. Okay. Now, those of you who are already in front, just talk to Jesus Christ. Ask Him to have mercy on you. Ask Him to save your soul. And promise Him that you will serve Him from now on. And I will pray for your salvation too. I thank you. The rest of us, please let's stretch our hands towards these people and pray for them, that the one who saved our souls will save their own souls also. Intercede for them. Pray that the Almighty God in His mercy will save the soul of every one of them. Please, let's intercede for them. And those of you in front, just cry to God, have mercy on me, save my soul, and I will serve you for the rest of my life. I will serve you for the rest of my life. Thank you, Father. Glory be to God. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Savior, we thank you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the sure mercies of David. Thank you for these people that have come forward to surrender their life to you. Father, please receive them. Save their souls. Today, let your blood wipe away their sins. Write their names in the book of life. And from now on, let them serve you. From this moment onward, anytime they cry unto you, answer them by fire. And let them serve you till the end. Thank you, my Father. And now, my Lord and my Savior, I'm committing your children to your hands. As many as are really determined to serve you all the days of their lives, when they cry unto you for mercy today, answer us all. In our homes, let us enjoy mercy. In our places of work, let us enjoy mercy. In our villages and towns, let us enjoy your mercy. Lord, even in our nations, let us enjoy your mercy. Thank you, my Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord. I want to rejoice with those of you who have come forward today. I can assure you the mercy of God will continue now to be available for you. So I'm going to need your names, your address, and your prayer request, so that I can continue to pray for you. The counselors will attend to you in a moment. But even before you go, I want you to be part of the initial prayer we're about to pray before we begin to really sing and dance and praise God. Anybody here ready to cry to God for mercy? I'll stand on your feet and shout a big hallelujah. Bartimaeus cried for mercy. God changed his darkness to light. That woman whose daughter was being disturbed by demons cried for mercy. The devil left her family alone. That leper who was completely incurable cried to God for mercy, and God reversed the irreversible for him. I want you to cry to God with all your heart and say, Almighty God, please have mercy on me. Go ahead, talk to the Almighty God.